Okay, good afternoon. So let us start with our afternoon session on digital logic and logic circuits. In this session, we learn how to basically make logic for digital problems. Consider the example of automatic sliding doors. So in automatic sliding doors, what we have is we have door panels and sliding mechanisms. So door panel are the actual doors which will slide so as to open the way or to block the way. Sliding mechanisms are which will make the doors actually slide, open and close. Since the fundamental problem is to move the doors, so obviously the first thing that we need is an actuator. So in this picture, as you see, what we see is a DC brushless motor. Then we need some control system to do the operation. So a control module is shown here. Then is the function linking PCB, so a printed circuit board for auxiliary functioning. Then this is the hardware, which consists of brackets for attaching the doors, and of course the belt and pulley arrangement as you see here, which will slide the doors so as to open them or close them. Now if we see the general sliding mechanism components, we'll have an actuator, a motor, then a transformer for converting AC to DC, etc. Then a controller, then hardware like return pulleys and brackets. This is shown as the timing belt, torque belt. And then primarily we need some kind of sensors. For example, the sensors shown here are microwave sensors. So we may have microwave, infrared, any type of sensors. So now how to connect the sensors and actuators in a circuit? Now when we have a controller in a circuit, it's fairly easy to connect the sensors and actuators. You simply connect all the sensors to the controller on one side, on the input side, and all the actuators to the controller on the output side. We need not be worried about that, about their arrangement. The rest of the work will be done by the logic. But the main thing is how to make the logic. So we'll do that by taking the example of you can say a PLC. Although logic is general in nature and it can be implemented in any type of controller. Now, before we go to the next slides, I will now go to the board and we will discuss the problems of formulating logic. So we'll just adjust the camera. Focus, try to recalibrate. Okay. Now we started with the problem of sliding door mechanism. So with any mechanism, we have an actuator. Here also we have an actuator, which is a motor. So let us say that this is a room. And we need sliding doors to be mounted here.
सब ठीक है। Now, as we saw that for moving the door, we need a motor and sensors. Now, in case a person approaches the door from outside, then we need a sensor outside. And if the person approaches the door from inside, then we need a sensor on the inside. So participants in the studio, you can turn your faces to this side, easier for you. And then we will have a motor which will operate the door. So this symbol is.
Excuse me.
Yes, please.
Excuse me.
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Sir, is it not audible, sir? This is not audible, please.
Okay, so I think we'll have to move the mic or we can just. Also, please let me know about the video. Is the video clear? Like, please let me know the diagram that I'm drawing on the board. Is that clear?
Wire length is limited. और आ जाएगा ना बेटे। ओके। Okay, so this is a motor, right? Now I will make another figure. See, this is the motor, and we know to operate a motor we need a circuit. So this is the simplest possible circuit to run a motor, having a power supply and a switch. So remember, we are starting our discussion in which controller will not be a part of, but slowly we will converge on to that, what are the advantages of including a controller. Now it is very obvious that if we close the switch, the motor will work, and if we open the switch, the motor will stop. So let us assume that there is a, instead of a sensor, there is a manual switch outside. And similarly, a manual switch inside. So a person can come, press the switch, the motor will work, the door will open, the person will pass through, and let us assume that after that springs will bring the door back into closed position. So this is a switch. Now this switch may be outside. Similarly, because we need two switches, one for outside, one for inside, so we have to place the second switch also in the circuit. Now by inspection only, here we see that if this switch is closed, let us say this is the outside switch, So if this switch is closed, the motor will work, and when the switch is open, the motor will stop working. Now by inspection, we can find out that how do we place the other switch also in the circuit, so that if we operate either of the switches, the motor will work. So what we have done, we have placed two switches in series, in parallel. Now if somebody closes this switch, if this switch is closed, the circuit will be complete here and the motor will work. Whereas if somebody closes this switch, then also the circuit will be complete and the motor will work. So for such a simple arrangement, merely by inspection we can come to know how do we make a logic circuit. Similarly, if I make another diagram, all of us can very easily see that how will the system work. The motor will work only when both the switches are closed, because then only the circuit will be complete. So one switch may be a supervisor switch and one may be an operator switch, so that when the operator closes the switch, the system will work only and only if the supervisor has also given a green signal, otherwise the circuit will not work. Now if we look at these two diagrams and observe their functioning, they are working on two very standard logics. OR logic and logic. Now a very important step in formulating digital logic is to make truth tables. In truth tables, what we do is we make a table of inputs and outputs. For example, here if we call this input as A and this the second input as B and the output as P, then for this circuit the truth table can be made correlating P, the state of P, to the states of A and B. Again, for making truth tables, we make use of binary numbers or bits. Binary digits, that is 0 and 1. So if we assume that when the switch is open, we will denote it by the binary digit 0, and if the switch is closed, we will denote it with binary digit 1, then we can represent the different possible states of the A and B switches. Similarly, when either of the switches is closed and the motor is working, So for the motor to be in working condition, we will use 1, and when the motor is not working, we will use 0. So one possibility is that both the switches are open. When both are open, the motor will not work. Now let us say switch B is closed and switch A is open. So switch B is closed and switch A is open. Now since the circuit is complete through this path, so therefore the motor will work. Another possibility is that switch B is open and switch A is closed. So switch B is open and switch A is closed. Now the circuit is complete through this path. So now also the motor will work. The fourth possibility is that both the switches A and B are closed. Now again, because the circuit is complete, the motor will operate. There is no more possibility. So here we had two inputs. Both the inputs are binary, therefore the number of possible combinations are 2^n, where n is number of inputs. So these four combinations were possible. Now if we look at the adjoining circuit, since here are also two inputs, that means therefore possible combinations are 4, and the combinations will also be same. Either both are open or B is closed or A is closed or both A and B are closed. Now looking at this circuit, we can very easily see that if both the switches are open, the motor will not work. If B is closed and A is open, that is this state, then also the circuit is incomplete and the motor will not work. When A is closed but B is open, then also the circuit is incomplete and the motor will not work. Only when both A and B are closed, then only the circuit is complete and the motor will work. So we have a truth table for this circuit as well as for this circuit. Now for this particular problem, what we did was we just made this circuit by inspection, and from that we made the truth table. And here we just made another circuit, and from the circuit we made the truth table. actually the process is reverse. We first make the truth table and then from there we derive the logic circuit. Now I will go to the laptop and just write the steps in Word, 4-5 steps that how do we make the logic, and then we'll again come back to the board.
So normally what we will have is we are given a problem for which we have to make the circuit. So how do we make the circuits? I will just write 3-4 steps for that and then we will go back to the board. Step 1, we identify inputs and outputs. I will just reduce the font size so that we can have, because I think it's quite visible. Okay. This is okay. Now, from the problem statement, we will know that how should inputs and outputs interact. So after identifying inputs and outputs, we will make truth table. Then from the truth table, we will formulate Boolean expression and we will simplify Boolean expression by using Boolean algebra, and then from the simplified Boolean expression we will formulate the logic circuit. Right. So first step is to identify inputs and outputs, second step is to make truth table, third step is to formulate Boolean expression from truth table. I should write here. And next step is to simplify the Boolean expression by using Boolean algebra. And from there we can formulate the circuit, the logic circuit. Now let us implement these four steps by using an example. So we'll again go to the board. So these two diagrams of the truth tables I am going to erase. Now let us write a problem statement using this room only. Now let us say that what we want is that if a person comes from outside, presses that door should open. But simultaneously, if a person has pressed the door from inside, then the switch from inside, then the door should not open. So I will repeat the problem. A person comes from outside, presses the switch, and the door opens. He passes, goes into the room, the door closes. A person comes from inside, presses the switch, the door opens. Then he passes through the door again closes. Now in case two persons approach the door, one from outside, one from inside, and they simultaneously press the switches, then the door should not open. Why? Because there is a danger of the people striking each other. Now, that is the problem statement. Now, from this problem statement, our first step is to identify inputs and outputs. We already have the inputs and outputs identified here. There is one switch outside and one switch inside. So, these are two inputs and a motor to open the door, that is the output actuator. So again, let us say the outside switch is A, the inside switch is B, and the motor is Q or B, whatever. So we have first step to identify inputs and output that we have done. So the first step is identifying inputs and outputs. So we have two inputs and one output. Second is to make truth table. Now from our past two examples, we know that for two inputs, we have four possible combinations. There is nobody present outside, nobody present inside, motor does not work. A person presses the switch from inside, but nobody has pressed the switch outside the room, so the door opens. Third possibility is a person has pressed the switch from outside, nobody has done it from inside, the door should open. Now two people come and simultaneously press the switches. So we want that door should not open. So that is the truth table. Now after writing the truth table, now our next step is to formulate the Boolean expression. Again, there are steps of formulating Boolean expression and there are different methods also. The method which I will be demonstrating here is called sum of products. So there are different methods. I am going to follow the method sum of products. Now in this method, what we do is we focus our attention to those rows where the output is 1. Because the logic is meant to operate the output.
So in this we have these two rows
where the output is 1 and the output is 0 in the other two rows.
Now in this row, in the you can say this is the second row basically. It is the first row, second row, third row and fourth row.
Now for each of the second and third rows, we will write the expression for Q is equal to A into P.
So for row number 2,
if we write the expression Q is equal to A dot B or A by A dot B, now here A is 0, B is 1, so 0 into 1 will be 0, whereas actually the Q is 1. So what we will do, we will modify this expression and write it as A complement into B. Now we know that we are dealing with binary digits. Which can have a value of either 0 or 1. So if we have a binary digit say C which is 0, then the complement of C is 1. Similarly, if we have a binary digit D which is 1, then the complement of D is 0. So when we write complement of a binary digit, we are basically writing 1 in place of 0 or 0 in place of 1. So here, since A was 0, so A complement is 1. So 1 into 1 is equal to 1. Now we will apply the same technique to row number 3. In row number 3, A is 1, whereas B is 0, so we took B complement so that it is 1 into 1, that is 1. Now after writing the output as the product of inputs, then we are going to take its sum. So we will say that combining them, Q is so this is the sum of products method. So the third step is so that is what we have just done. We have formulated the Boolean expression as this. Fourth step is
simplify Boolean expression, which in this case is not possible, because remember we are talking of algebra, Boolean algebra. So like in algebra you can take some common terms, so similarly here also you can take common terms, but in both these terms there is no common term. Here we have a bar dot b, here we have a dot b bar. So neither a is common nor a bar is common, similarly neither b is common nor b bar is common. So this step will not apply to this example. Now we will return back to this, but please let us go back to our presentation and we'll again come back here. So if there are any questions, we will take it after we go through our presentation. Okay. So we started with the example of a sliding door. So next we see a number system. The number system that we use in our daily lives is decimal system. It has a base 10. Why? Because we use 10 digits 0 through 9. So I will say we use symbols 0 to 9, that is 10 symbols we use. So that is why we say that the base is 10. In binary system that we were discussing on the board, the base is 2. Why? Because only two symbols are used, 0 and 1. Similarly, there are many more systems, hexadecimal, octal system. So just as an example, I am writing here hexadecimal. Right? Hexa means 6. We have hexagon of 6 sides. Decimal means 10. So total of 16 symbols. So the base is 16. And the symbols are 0 to 9 and then A to F. So binary number system is used to represent and manipulate numbers with digital devices. The reason for this is that the operation of digital devices is based on transistors that switch between two states, on and off states. These states may be designated by the symbols 1 and 0 in the base 2 system. Boolean algebra is an algebra that deals with binary variables and logic operations. The three basic logic operations are AND, OR, NOT, or complement. AND, OR we saw in our two circuit diagrams, and NOT complement we used in our third example. A Boolean function can be either 1 or 0. Now, this is some basic Boolean theorems where X is a binary variable. For example, we are saying x dot 0 is equal to 0. Now, one thing more, when we say dot or product, we are talking of AND logic. When we say plus, we are talking of OR logic. So, product implies AND, plus implies OR. So, here we are saying x and 0 is equal to 0. Now, since x is a binary variable, it may be 0, it may be 1. If it is 0, then we are saying 0 and 0 is equal to 0. If it is 1, we are saying 1 and 0 is equal to 0. That is what we saw in our AND truth table for the AND circuit. Similarly, x and 1 will be equal to x. For example, if x is 0, 0 and 1 is 0. If x is 1, 1 and 1 is 1.
x and x is x. That is also true. 0 and 0 is 0, 1 and 1 is 1. X and x complement is 0. If x is 0, then this becomes 1. So 0 and 1 is 0. Similarly, 1 and 0 is 0. Now we come to OR. We say x or 0 is equal to x. If x is 0, then 0 or 0 is 0. If x is 1, then 1 or 0 is 1. Similarly, 1 plus 1 is 1, but 0 plus 1 is also 1. We saw in the OR circuit. 0 or 0 is 0, 1 or 1 is 1, that also we saw. Similarly, 0 or 1 will always be 1, 1 or 0 will always be 1. So if x is 0, then actually here it is double complement. It may not be visible, but it is a double complement. So that is complement of complement. So if x is 0, its complement is 1, and further the complement of 1 is 0. So therefore, x double complement is equal to x. Now these are some more Boolean expressions, Boolean algebra. X dot y is equal to y dot x. Commutative law, the same holds true in our day-to-day algebra also. Similarly, x plus y is equal to y plus x. So where x and y both are Boolean variables or binary variables having value of either 0 or 1. X into yz is equal to xy into z. X plus y plus z, where y plus z are bracketed, is equal to x plus y bracketed plus z. Associative law. X and y or z is equal to x and y or x and z. Similarly, x or y and w or z is equal to this. Distributive law, same as in our day-to-day life algebra. Now, these are some consensus theorems which are very useful actually. So, it says x plus x bar y is equal to x plus y. Similarly, x bar plus xy is equal to x bar plus y. X plus x bar y bar is equal to x plus y bar. X bar plus xy bar is equal to x bar plus y bar. And these are De Morgan's theorems, which says that complement of x and y is equal to complement of x plus complement of y. Similarly, complement of x or y is complement of x and complement of y. Now, these expressions are very important when we are deriving logic circuits from given statements. So, digital logic is the word digital implies that the information is represented by variables that take a limited number of discrete values. Binary variables are also digital because they only take two values. Computers and microprocessor control systems involve digital signals with two possible signal levels. The two levels, high and low, are represented by binary digits 1 and 0. Now let us come to logic gates. We have just seen some logic gates. So these are the basic building blocks for digital electronic circuits. First of all, let us see AND. So we have just seen that if we have two inputs A, B, then the output A and B is given by this relation. And in our first example, we formulated this truth table from the physical layout of the circuit. Whereas on the left hand side, what you see is an AND symbol for this. There is a link also. We'll link about. Okay, that is just not required right now. Okay, then Next is OR. A, B are two inputs and output is A or B. So this truth table we also formulated from our circuit, from the physical circuit that we had made. And this is the symbol for the OR gate or OR logic. Then NOT. NOT is complement. So what we say is if the input is 0, then its output is 1. If the input is 1, then output is 0. So after we go through these tables, we will make physical circuits for them showing that how do they actually relate with the real life. NOT AND. Now, if you remember that for two inputs A, B, the AND is 0, 0, 0, 1. So where NAND, whereas NAND is not of AND. So if we have an input A, B, then A and B is what we just saw. And this is the and output of A, B. Whereas when we say NAND, we basically mean not AND. Right. Or you can say complement of AND. So what is the complement of 0? It is 1. Complement of 0, 1. Complement of 0, 1. Complement of 1, 0. Right. So, that is what we were seeing in the NAND. The complement of similarly, this is complement of OR, not OR, that is NOR. So, whereas for A, B, OR will be 0, 1, 1, 1, NOR will be 1, 0, 0, 0. And you also look at the symbols. This is the symbol for the OR gate. And if we put a small circle here, it becomes NOT of OR or NOR. Similarly, if we go to the previous slide, this is the symbol of AND, this is the symbol of NOT. Then this is exclusive OR or XOR, what is called. Now if you look at this truth table is same as we just formulated for our problem, that when you want to open the door, only when one switch is operated. If both the switches are operated, the door should not open. So this is the same truth table that we just formulated. So it is XOR. Okay, then we need not do this. So this we have already basically, these are different truth tables. You can just take 2 minutes and go through the truth tables, then I will resume. Here A and B are inputs and C is the output. phones would be available. Okay, so now we have okay, so before we go to some videos, so what is shown here is basically a NAND IC, just an example taken from internet, that for making you can say electronic logic circuits, we have different kinds of ICs available which contain the different type of logics. This is an example of a NAND IC. Now we come to logic circuits, but before we come to logic circuits, let us see some videos for AND, OR, NOT, NAND, NOR, XOR. Now it is the same PLC that you saw in the morning. So again, we will only see the videos. The logic we will discuss tomorrow, how it was formulated. So here we are seeing the videos to emphasize that actually when we say AND or X or NOT, what do we mean by that? So here the problem is, statement is, a motor runs, when two contacts are closed and stops when either or both contacts are opened. So we just made a diagram on the board also, but here we are. So if you look at this program for this logic, you will see it is similar to the kind of diagrams I made on the board. For example, if this is one switch I8, second switch I9, and the motor Q6, so if we close the circuit like this, that is, you have a power supply here, which is, we can say, not shown, then this will make a complete circuit, and when both I8 and I9 are closed, then only the motor will run. Now, before we run the video, let us identify. As I discussed in the morning, this is input number 8. This is input number 9. And this is our output motor Q6. Now this switch and this switch both are attached to the PLC on the input side, and the motor is also attached to the PLC on the output side. Let us see the video.
I8.
So there are two switches, I8 and I9. So only when both are pressed, then only the motor will work. So this was AND logic. Now let us see OR logic. A motor runs when either or both contacts are closed and stops when both contacts are opened. Now it is the same I8, I9 and same output, but now the logic is different. And again, if I say that there is a power supply here, then you will see that this diagram is similar to the kind of diagram we made on the board. Not logic. A motor which is running stops while a contact is closed. So in this, a switch I8 and an output Q6, you will see in the video. So this is I8 and this is Q6. So when the video runs, this motor will rotate, and when I8 is closed, then only the motor will stop, otherwise the motor will run. So it is now not logic or complement. Now the motor is running. When I8 is pressed, the motor stops. When it is released, it runs. So now here we are talking of complement. So this we will see tomorrow. Now this is NOR. This also we'll see tomorrow. Now let us see this XOR, right, which we just formulated, which is exclusive OR logic. A motor runs only when either of two contacts is closed. Now here, when either I8 or I9 is closed, then only the motor will run. When both are open, the motor will not run. Also, when both are closed, then also motor will not run. So that is the logic. Let's just see the video. Right, so here we demonstrated the AND logic, the OR logic, the NOT or the complement, and exclusive OR, that is XOR. Now we'll talk of logic circuits. First of all, let us go through some problems. For example, it says, design a start circuit for a semi-automated punching machine with three variables as control parameters. The three variables are protective guard signal A, remote start signal B, and normal start signal C. The truth table for implementation is given. So here, in fact, rather than giving the problem statement, the inputs are given and directly the truth table is given. We'll come back to this problem. Let us see another problem. An industrial furnace is to be controlled as follows. The contacts of a bimetallic strip inside the furnace close if the temperature falls below the set point and open when the temperature is above the set point. The contacts regulate a control relay which turns on and off the heating elements of the furnace. If the door to the furnace is opened, the heating elements are temporarily turned off until the door is closed. Specify the inputs and output variables for the system operation. Write the Boolean expression for the operation. So if we look at this problem, so from here we have to identify what are the inputs and what are the outputs. So I'll just give the participants in the studio and at the remote centers to try to list the inputs and outputs. Then after 2 minutes, then I will interject and we will discuss. So participants at the remote centers and in the studio, they can try to write on their notepads that in this problem, what are the inputs and what are the outputs. So, okay, if we discuss this problem, actually there is one more step that you can add to the steps which I had discussed about formulating Boolean expressions. And that one step is you can make a rough sketch of the system, because that also gives us a good idea about the different components. For example, here we are talking of a furnace. The first line is an industrial furnace is to be controlled, right? Now, the context of a bimetallic strip inside the furnace close if the temperature falls below set point. So that means the sensor is basically a bimetallic strip, the kind of strip which we have in our household irons. So they close if the temperature falls below the set point and open when the temperature is above the set point. So there is a circuit consisting of these bimetallic strips. Now, what does this circuit further consist of? It says the contacts regulate a control relay. That means there is a relay which is being operated by these bimetallic strips, which turns on and off the heating elements of the furnace. And then further that control relay operates the heating elements of the furnace. Further it says if the heat door to the furnace is open, the heating elements are temporarily turned off until the door is closed. So if we say make a circuit of this, try to make a circuit of this. I think I'll again have to go to the board. So we'll discuss this problem in detail. So first of all, let us say that we have a furnace, and naturally in the furnace what we need is a heating element. And what the heating element needs is a power supply. Now to open and close, to start or stop the heating, what we need is a switch. Now here this switch is a control relay basically. This switch is a control relay. Now this relay is either opened or closed depending upon the states of the bimetallic strip or by the doors of the furnace. So inside the furnace, the sensor is a bimetallic strip power supply, so this I have shown as a power supply. Now this bimetallic strip is sensing the temperature. If the temperature is below the set point, the strip is like this, and if the temperature is above the set point, then because bimetallic strips have different materials with different coefficient of expansion, so what happens, they distort. So when they distort, the circuit is opened.
So that means when the temperature is high, the bimetallic strip will distort and the circuit, this circuit will open. When this circuit open, the input to the control relay is removed and the control relay will also break this circuit and the heating element will be switched off. So as the heating element is switched off, the temperature in the furnace will come down. So when the temperature in the furnace comes down, this bimetallic strip will again become straight, and as it becomes straight, the circuit will again, the secondary circuit will again be established. When that happens, this control relay is switched on. When this is switched on, the heating element will also start giving the heat. Now, apart from a bimetallic strip to sensor temperature sensor in the furnace, there is another thing, the doors to the furnace are opened or closed. So that is also detected by some switch. There is a switch which is detecting whether the doors are open or closed. It may be some kind of a mechanical switch which remain closed when the doors are closed, but if the doors are open, this switch also opens. Now, since these two inputs are in series, the switch and the bimetallic strip, that means for the heating element to be on, the control relay has to be working. For the control relay to be working, this circuit should be complete. So that means the bimetallic strip should be touching the contacts as well as this switch should be closed. So from this sketch, we can easily sense that there are two inputs, a bimetallic strip and a mechanical switch maybe to sense the door status. And of course, the output here is the control relay. Let's call it Q. So we have identified the inputs and outputs. Now we have to make truth table. There are two inputs, both are binary. This is either closed or opened. Similarly, this is also either closed or opened. So both A and B are binary. So their possible states are you can easily see that only when both of them are closed, then only the coil will be heating. So the truth table will be like this, exactly an AND logic. And from here we have to formulate a Boolean expression. Although it is fairly simple, but let us just revise the steps. So for formulating Boolean expression, we have to focus on only those rows where output is 1, which in this case is row number 4. And here Q will be A into B. So this is our Boolean expression, and obviously we cannot simplify it, so we cannot simplify the expression. So for this given problem, we have identified the inputs and outputs and we have formulated the Boolean expression.
So now we'll go back to our next. Presentation PPT. So next we discuss the another problem, which is the last for today's session. It says, consider a chemical tank for which three variables, level, pressure, and temperature are to be monitored. Design a circuit for sounding an alarm if any of the following combinations occurs. First combination is liquid level is low and pressure is high. Second is liquid level is high and temperature is high. Third is high liquid level with low temperature and high pressure. Right. Now, because we will have to do it on the board, so I request the participants that if they can note down this problem, so after 2 minutes, so in 2 minutes you can note down the problem, it's a very small one. So after 2 minutes we'll go to the board and solve this problem. Okay, then we'll discuss the problem on the board. So from this problem statement, we can see that we are going to measure three variables, level, pressure and temperature. So say there are three sensors, one for level, one for pressure and one for temperature. So when we identify the inputs, we say we have three sensors and we name the inputs as L, P, T. And output is an alarm. It says design a circuit for sounding an alarm. So an alarm is an output. We call it Q. Now in the second step, we have to make truth table. So depending upon the states of level, pressure and temperature sensors, the alarm should work. Now we just discussed that the number of possible combinations of binary variables, they depend upon the how many binary variables are there. Where small n is the number of variables. So these are the possible number of combinations 2^n. Now here small n is equal to 3 because there are 3 input variables L, P and T. So accordingly here we have possible 8 combinations. But remember we are interested in only those combinations for which output is 1. So rather than writing all the possible combinations, we will read the conditions for which the alarm has to be sounded and accordingly we will make the truth table. The first condition is liquid level is low and pressure is high. So let us make a decision that we will denote low value with a 0 and high value with a 1. So when the liquid level is low and pressure is high, the alarm should sound. Now this condition does not talk about temperature. Temperature may be low or temperature may be high. In both conditions the alarm should work. So in case the temperature is low, then this becomes 0, 1, 0 and 1. However, for the same condition, that is low level and high pressure, if the temperature is high, then also we need to sound the alarm. Second is level is high and temperature is high. Level is high and temperature is high, then alarm should work. Here this second condition does not talk about the pressure. So maybe the pressure is low or pressure is high, alarm should work. The third condition says high liquid level, low temperature and high pressure. So here it specifies, the third condition specifies all the three variable states. High liquid level, so L is 1, low temperature
P is 0 at high pressure. So this condition says that alarm should work. Now as per the given conditions, we have formulated the truth table. Now our next step is to formulate the Boolean expression. For the first row, Q will be equal to L bar or L complement into P into T complement. So wherever we have a zero occurring, we are taking a complement of that so that all the terms are 1, 1, 1. For the second row, Q will be L complement into P into T. For the third row, Q will be L dot P complement dot T. For the fourth row, it will be Q equal to L dot P dot T. L dot P dot T complement. So the combined Boolean expression will be sum of all these terms. Now for this particular problem, we will have to go to the fourth step, that is simplify Boolean expression. Now how we will simplify it? So we have to take some common terms. For example, if we look in the first two terms, here L complement and P are common. Similarly, if you look at third and fourth, then L dot T are common. Then last, we will write as such. Now from our slides on Boolean algebra, remember x bar plus x is always equal to 1. X plus x bar or x bar plus x is also always equal to 1. So this will be always equal to 1. Similarly, p bar plus p will always be equal to 1. Now, if there is any further common term, you can take it, it helps you. again from Boolean expression x plus 1 or 1 plus x, we should remember it is always equal to 1. So we have simplified the Boolean expression to this. Now there is no common term that we can take. Now I arrived at this Boolean expression because I combined first two, then next two. So if somebody does it by using different combinations, this may turn out to be somewhat different also, but there is nothing wrong with that. Now, one more thing that we should remember, and we can even recollect from our first two examples, that when switches are in series, the truth table is that of AND. Similarly, when the switches are in parallel, the truth table is that of OR. Further, we say that AND we represent by a product and OR we represent by a plus sign. So for this, what we have is, we have two inputs connected by dot. That means L complement and P should be in series when we are talking of a logic diagram. Similarly, L and P should be in series in the logic. Whereas this term and this term, it should be parallel to each other. Now we can represent this in many ways. For example, if we represent it using the symbols that you saw in the AND or truth tables in electronic symbols, then we may say L P T. L complement. So this is the symbol of complement. So that means this is L bar. Now L bar and P, they are to be in AND. Similarly, L and T are to be in OR. In AND. These two are to be connected by an OR. So in terms of logic gate symbols, the logic diagram is this. Whereas in terms of PLC or ladder, then we can also use the same technique to formulate a ladder diagram. So that we will do when we discuss the PLC programming tomorrow. So I hope that the problem, that the example that we have discussed today, you please remember, because tomorrow we will use the same examples to learn how to program PLCs for these kind of things. And when we program, we will also see them in action using a simulator of the PLC. Now we'll stop here. So if there is any question from the centers or from the participants in the studio, you can ask. So I'll request the centers one by one. Gyan Jyoti, if there is any question.
No sir, no question from our side.
Thank you.
Then Punjab University Regional Center, Sharpur.
Bolo sir. Yes sir, I have question.
Yeah.
Through KMap, I am getting the output P plus LP.
So, pardon?
Through KMap, Carnot map, if we...
Yeah. That's what I said. That by either you are using Karnaugh maps or you are using sum of products or product of sums or whatever, right? So number one is you arrive at a Boolean expression, and when you simplify it, even during simplification, if two people combine different terms, the net final expression may differ.
But the number of gates increases.
That's right. So it comes to efficiency, right? So that which one is the most efficient?
Yes.
Say, because in that case, if we can reduce the number of gates to minimum, that is always good, right? That is always good, even whether it is a hardware wise or whether we are doing a PLC program, there also naturally if we are simplifying the logic, it is always good.
Thank you.
Yeah.